In 2004, our next guest won a Tony Award for her portrayal of Elphaba, the Wicked Witch of the West, in the hit Broadway musical Wicked. Before that, she was nominated for her role as Maureen in Rent. She also starred in the film version. Now, Idina Menzel can be seen on the small screen in a recurring role on the hit TV series Glee. And her latest project, Idina Menzel Live, Barefoot at the Symphony, is premiering tonight exclusively right here on WTTW, and here is a look.
Your turn at bat, sir. At least I didn't fake it. Ha, sir, I guess I didn't make it. Get ready for me, love, cause I'm a comer. I simply gotta march my heart to drop a low. Buddy, low, low, buddy. It's gonna rain on my
And Idina Menzel, welcome to Chicago tonight.
Thank you. I'm so happy to be here.
You've got a lot of fans here in Chicago.
Thanks.
Well, let me ask you about that performance of Don't Rain on My Parade.
I was just going to say, you don't want, you know, I'm glad that they do those cavities with the white fillings now instead of the gold, because you could just see everything.
Oh, you have a perfect smile. Nothing to worry about.
That's my big mouth.
But Barbara Streisand was in the audience when you were singing that. How intimidating.
Not in my PBS concert, at Kennedy Center.
At the Kennedy Center, yes. What is it like singing one of her signature songs in front of Barbara herself?
It's just terrifying. It's terrifying for the 2 months you know about it beforehand, and it's pretty scary the whole time. But I meditated a lot right before I got out there, and I told myself to have fun. And you know, you're just happy to be included in that company of people, and you just gotta say, look, this is what I wanted to do ever since I was a little girl, and if I'm getting an opportunity like this, I have to take it. But it was so scary.
It was scary. Mm-hmm. You also performed for President and Mrs. Obama.
That's the other one.
Was it more intimidating to sing for the president and his wife or for Barbara Streisand?
Okay, I would probably say Barbara Streisand, except for the fact that the one for the president was in a much smaller room, and he was right in the front row. And every time I was singing, if I spit at all, I felt like I was just gonna get him straight in the eye. So that was, and they also said, don't, you can look at him when you sing, don't feel like you have to look past him, you know? And I was so afraid to meet his eye and then forget my lyrics. And so that was another scary one. We're just starting the interview off with all of my moments.
But this is interesting, you know, because I've heard that for some performers, it's better not to be able to focus in on one person, and it's better to, you don't get unnerved.
I like that.
So if you see somebody's face that you recognize, that can actually be, a little unnerving, especially if it's
one
the president?
One time I was doing a show, an off-Broadway show called See What I Want to See down at the Public in New York, and I've never worked with Stephen Sondheim, unfortunately. It's something that I hope to do one day, and we were in the small little theater where it's sort of not in the round, but like that. Anyway, for the first time ever, I decided to look in the audience while I have a moment, and it's on spotlights and somebody else, and there he is right in front of me. And for the rest of the show, there was no lyrics, there was no intention for my character. All I was saying in my mind was, Stephen Sondheim, Stephen Sondheim, Stephen
Sondheim. You know, they say that one actually performs better in an audience full of strangers than people you know.
And that
people.
Is so true.
Is that true in your
case?
For
me, it is,
would you say? All right, well, listen. On the new PBS special, your conductor is Marvin Hamlisch. Mm-hmm. And again, you know, you're talking about these legendary people in show business, whether it's Sondheim or Streisand, performing somebody who is responsible for so much outstanding, wonderful music, to collaborate with him.
He's, as we say, a mensch. He's an incredible musician, but even more than that, he's the kindest, funniest man, and he's just teaching me so much. We had a concert that we did. What are we watching? Oh, that's us.
That is you.
Can I talk over it while
sure,
it's going?
Sure, go ahead. Yes.
Yeah, isn't he so cute? I love him so much.
He's very adorable. But you look pretty good too.
You'll see tonight on the show. We have a really good rapport with one another, and he keeps me actually, you know, calms me a little bit, and we throw it back and forth with each other. And he's very spontaneous, and I like to think that I'm spontaneous. But we've been doing these concerts with symphonies and orchestras for the last year and a half all over the country. We even went to Royal Albert Hall, and Marvin and I have been doing. We did about 10 or 12 of them together, and the first one was down in Washington, D.C., and We just sort of love at first sight, and I just feel...
So you have chemistry with the man.
I have chemistry with
musical
him.
Musical chemistry and also personal chemistry, it
Yes,
like.
Definitely. And the idea of him feeling that I'm good enough to with all the people that he's worked with, to stand up there and be the captain of the ship for me is just something that I have to kind of pinch myself all the time.
Well, let's backtrack a little bit. You know, you say you have to pinch yourself because you started out as a wedding singer and as a bar mitzvah singer. And how did those experiences sort of influence who you are today? What a cliche question, but I want to know.
But they really have. In good and bad ways, I think. When I was about 15 years old, my parents split up, and my dad, you know, moved out, and so then he was trying to, you know, pay for two households, and so I felt like I should get a job, and instead of the nearest deli or, you know, grocery or whatever, a friend of ours knew somebody that worked with a band called in Oceanside, Long Island. I'm getting into detail that you don't even need to know. But anyway, I got the job, but I was 15, but I lied, and I said I was 18 because I thought they would hire me and think I was more professional at the time. So here I am, jailbait, going into all of these weddings and bar mitzvahs on the weekends while my friends were at parties, you know, doing their thing. I was up there singing everything from Girl from Ipanema to every Madonna song at the time.
Probably had to do Houston. A lot of Motown.
Motown and then Billie Holiday, all the standards. It was the best
Proud
education
Mary, you probably
for,
sang a few
I was
times.
Pretty good at Proud Mary. Yeah, and then I sang all the other ones that weren't as much fun, like Hot, 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 and Come on, everybody, let's do the conga or whatever that one is. And but having to learn all that music, I used to literally use the drive to the gig in the car as a learning time for myself. You know, I'd put in Billie Holiday and Our Love Is Here to Stay and learn it while I was driving to the show and tell myself, you know what, I just wanna try to imitate her. Somewhere tonight, and whatever it is that I'm singing, just try to do that lick or that riff that she did. And I always tell people that ask me, you know, for advice and stuff, they should be themselves. But there's something about really studying the people that you love and emulating them and then letting it kind of pour out of you. And that's where you sort of see the separation of you and your influences.
Well, how did that experience come to bear in 1995 when you got this breakout role in Rent? I mean, it sounds like all this awareness that you developed, I mean, did that all sort of come out in some kind of way in your role as Maureen, for which you got so much acclaim?
Thanks. Gosh, I don't know. See, every time I hear music, I have to look and wash myself. That's how vain I am, everyone.
No,
I can't lie.
Well, it's not vanity. It's what you do. And, you know, I would imagine that as a performer, you're always sort of interested in, how did I do? Because it sounds like you learn not just from other people, but I assume mm-hmm. you learn from the performances that you give. On how to make something better the next time.
That is very true. And I think that, and I want to get back to the question that I probably will forget, but you have to get me back on track. But I feel like I've been really lucky to learn from the roles that I've gotten to play, that they've informed me and I've informed them. I've been a part of the process of developing these original characters, and yet when I look back, I, as Idina, really needed to learn a life lesson at that time, and often they're synonymous with the you know, trajectory that character was on.
Well, so it was in Rent that you met your
right,
you, met,
right,
you, met
thank
your,
you.
You met your husband,
Tay
Diggs,
my husband.
And then the two of you went on to perform on Sesame Street, and we have a clip. Let's watch.
That
it.
Was recent, yeah.
Idina, Tay, I'm sorry I'm late. I'm here to help you explain the word allergic. Hey, what's wrong with him?
Oh, he's allergic to dogs.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
Not a problem. I'll send someone else to help.
Okay. What is it like? Is that the only time you perform with your husband?
No. Well, we performed a lot. You know, we did Rent. We did Wild Party. You mean on Sesame Street?
Yeah.
Well, we'd love to go back. We'd love to sing a little song or something.
I want to ask you what Elmo is really like.
But no, what I have to tell you is that my husband and I actually had a little argument that day because he was directing me too much on the line reading of how we were supposed to say it. We
went home. Micromanaging?
Yes, he was.
Well,
how can you fight when you're doing a taping of Sesame Street? And my son Walker could care less. You know, maybe he'll care in two more years, but right now we go to show him and he doesn't care.
Let's back up to Wicked, and before we talk about it, let's see a clip of you and Wicked.
Okay. Why?
Because we're
the one you want. It's me.
Okay.
It's me.
So if you care to find me,
look to the western sky
as
someone's
home.
I'm looking at your expression. I'm trying to figure out what.
Because it's scary. Because my eyes. I mean, I was playing a witch, so I guess it's okay. But I'm scared myself.
Oh, come on.
And, you know, I think, I don't know. Was that at the Tonys or something? That was an incredible day. Was that at the Tonys? I don't even know.
May have been.
Let me parlay into my award-winning afternoon, evening. No, but it's such a funny story because the.
Are you always watering, tearing up?
Are they crying about myself? No,
I'm.
It's probably just my eyeliner.
Oh, okay, fine. I was wondering because. You know, it could be, I was wondering.
I have a little cold, maybe that's
well,
what
Well, I was wondering if maybe it brought back some memories or something like that.
No, you didn't get me to cry yet about it.
No, that's not what I was asking. I just wanted to make sure my eyes were not deceiving me. But as you see yourself.
No, but it was a very emotional day for me. And I just, you know, that day at the Tonys, you have to go early in the morning and do like a camera rehearsal. And then you go home, you have some time, then you have to go back. They wanted me to put the green makeup on so that they could test it in front of the camera. So I had to put the green makeup on at 8 in the morning. I go, I do the whole thing. I'm nervous as hell, right? And then I go home, I go take a yoga class. My skin is breaking out because I've been so nervous all week and doing, you know, playing. So I don't even want to look at myself in the mirror during yoga, so I decide. I leave early, which I've never done before. I go home. My husband is taking a nap. Is this too long of a story?
No, it's good.
Okay, so my husband's taking a nap. He's calm. You know, it's not a big day for him. And my agent had written this this email to me saying, don't be your self-deprecating self and assume you're not going to win and not make sure you write a speech, prepare a speech. You have a chance or something like that. So I just started hysterically crying and snotting all over his chest and saying, I think I really do want to win and I act like I don't care, but it would be so great and I've worked so hard, but I don't know what to say. And anyway, so we go over there. He goes, well, let's talk about it. I'll just think about who the people you would like to thank. And we actually plan that. And then I go, now the makeup and hair people come to get all into the glamour, you know, gown and the whole thing for the red carpet, all pretty, work on that for 2.5 hours, then go spend a half hour there, take pictures, have to go upstairs, take it all off, put the green makeup on so I could perform that piece. Then I have a half hour to get in a shower that I went to 2 days before to make sure the water pressure was good so I could get that stupid green makeup off in time. Got it off and the makeup team put me back in. By the time I was sitting down, I had about 20 minutes before they called my name. And then I got up there and I hit all the points that my husband and I.
How long was the speech?
You're only allowed like 30 seconds or something.
Yeah, you said something that I want to follow up on, and that is use the term self-deprecating. Where does that come from, the self-deprecation? In spite of the fact that you've had this acclaimed career and everything, why self-deprecating?
I don't know, and I think the older I get, people are getting really irritated with me in my life. And now it's not cute. Now it's like, just get over yourself. Things are good, stop being like that. So, I can work on that in my therapy next week. But
no, but you said something before we went on the air.
I think it's because, you know, maybe being a wedding bar mitzvah singer, you just think someone's gonna take it away. I mean, you hear this from performers probably all the time. You don't want to be made a fool of. You know, you don't want to have all this excitement and then it goes away. And it's silly because that's not the way to live. And I try to, like with the rent, getting back to the question that I never talked about. It's about no day but today. It's about staying in the moment. And that's what his whole show is. Jonathan Larson, the composer, what he was teaching us. And I'm somewhat of a hypocrite there, but, you know, that's what I work on, trying to stay in the moment.
And another thing that you're working on right now is that you are on the show Glee. You have a recurring role in this wildly popular show about a Glee club and what goes on behind the scenes.
I've been having an affair with a student.
Oh, my
goodness.
I think that's illegal in this state. but it is.
They say he's 18, but, like, that's any better.
Let's see a clip from you and Glee.
Songs. ever written.
Isn't it fantastic? Getting back to Stephen Sondheim. But you and the actress who plays your daughter on the role, Lea Michele, looked like you could be related. I mean, there is a resemblance, and that is
like
that
mother-daughter or like sisters? You wanted to say
for me, it's more like sisters. So I know you play
I'm
her.
Sensitive about that.
Well, actually, you're too young to be her mother in any case.
I think I am, considering I have a 2-year-old. But you know, we take the jobs that we get, right? And if that's what I look like, then, you know, that's what I look like.
You look terrific, and you can play any of a number of roles. Idina Menzel, all the best to you. It's a pleasure.
Oh, my God, it's over already?
I was
a little nervous about this.
Well, no need to be over. Okay. No need to be nervous about it. Our interview is over, but your PBS special is coming up
right
after our show.